In this video, we derive the equations for projectile motion without drag, and then we apply the equations to the simplest projectile problem, which is a launch on a level surface. So what exactly is projectile motion? This means an object is moving in two dimensions, and the only force it feels is the downward force of gravity. This induces a downward acceleration, which near the surface of the Earth is about 9.8 meters per second squared in magnitude. And that magnitude is normally called little g, so we can say that our y acceleration, and that's at any moment in time on the trajectory, is a negative 9.8 meters per second squared, or symbolically, negative g. You'll notice that we're also given the initial position of the projectile, x0, y0, and we're given the initial velocity of the projectile, and that's already been broken into its velocity components, the initial x and y velocity. Now, given those initial conditions, and the fact that the acceleration is negative g in the y direction, our goal here is to describe the position and velocity of this projectile at any moment in time, at which point we can solve any conceivable problem with a projectile in it. And so at the bottom left, we have a reminder of how position, velocity, and acceleration are defined in a two-dimensional space. And so we start with the position vector, which is a vector that points from the origin to the actual ordered pair coordinates where the particle is located at some moment in time. And if we take the time derivative of those components, we get the velocity vector for any moment in time, and take the time derivative of those components again, we get the acceleration vector. So as we work toward trying to write down the velocity and position as a function of time for this projectile, we start with what we know about accelerations. And I know that ax is equal to 0. There is no acceleration in the x direction, it's purely a y direction thing. And that's just because there are no horizontal forces acting in the problem, which is true as long as we ignore drag forces. And then we have ay given by a negative g, so I have this constant downward acceleration induced by gravity. And I can see that all I have to do to get to the velocity components is just guess the antiderivatives of these two components. So what's the antiderivative of a zero? I'm getting my x velocity here. The antiderivative of zero is just some arbitrary constant c, and I'll write that explicitly as a function of time, because next we're going to apply the standard trick of evaluating this at t equals zero, which still gives me a c, but vx of zero has a name. That's the x component of my velocity when t is equal to zero, v naught x. And I arrive at my first equation, and that's vx equals v naught x. What does that say? It says the x component of the velocity is always the same number. It's equal to the initial value, which makes a lot of sense because we have no acceleration in the x direction. We continue to guess antiderivatives here, and I can get the position as a function of time by guessing the antiderivative of this x velocity component. And now it's a little more interesting. It's a v naught x times t plus an arbitrary constant, and then I apply the standard trick. I evaluate this at t equals zero. The v naught xt term vanishes, and I'm left with a c. But x of zero has a special name. That's our original x-coordinate of the projectile, so that's x0. And I get my second projectile motion equation, x equals x0, right, because c is equal to x0, plus v naught xt. And this is basically just the equation that says distance equals rate times time. That's how you describe motion when you have no acceleration, which is what's going on horizontally in the problem. Things are a little more complicated in the y direction. I find the antiderivative of the acceleration, which gives me a negative gt plus c. I evaluate that at t equals zero, which gives me a c. And vy of zero has a special name, that's v naught y, the initial y component of the velocity. This allows me to write down the y velocity as a function of time. That's v naught y minus gt. And then to get the y coordinate as a function of time, I guess antiderivatives again, and I end up with a v0yt minus a 1/2 gt squared, just using the power rule for antiderivatives there, plus an arbitrary constant c. And again, the standard trick is to evaluate this at t equals zero. When I do that, the first two terms vanish and I just get c, but y of zero has a special name, that's the initial y position, y naught. And I get an equation of motion for the y-coordinate. I'll move the constant to be the first term in this, so I get y naught plus v naught yt minus a 1/2 gt squared. So that's a pretty formal derivation of the equations for projectile motion. Note that we could summarize this by just saying that the x and y motions behave independently as one-dimensional kinematics problems. So when I have an acceleration of zero in the x direction, I end up with the standard equations I would get for a zero acceleration in a one-dimensional kinematics problem. I have an acceleration of negative g in the y direction. I get my standard one-dimensional kinematics equations describing the y coordinate. And these two things are just happening simultaneously throughout the projectile flight. So let's take a look at how to apply the projectile motion equations. This is the simplest case of projectile motion. And what I mean is that I have a completely level surface. So the height for the launch is the same as the height for the landing. I'm given an initial speed of 25 meters per second, inclined at an angle of 40 degrees for this launch. And our first step really is to nail down what are the initial conditions here. So I'm going to put the origin at the launch point. That's pretty standard. And that means x naught and y naught are equal to zero. And then I want to find the velocity components in this initial state. And v naught x is going to be a 25 cosine 40. This gives me 19.15 meters per second. V naught y is 25 sine 40. That gives me 16.07 meters per second. Then we get into our questions. In part A, we want the flight time for the projectile. And so the first step is to determine, is this a vertical question or a horizontal question? So I look at the end of the flight and I ask myself, what do I know at that point? And what I know at the end of the flight is that y is equal to zero. This flight ends when the ground gets in the way of the trajectory, and I know the y coordinate for that. So I'm going to start with a vertical analysis here. Again, I know the final y coordinate is zero when the flight ends. My initial y coordinate was also zero. Then I have my initial y velocity component that was 16.07. Half of g, if I take g to be 9.8, is 4.9. So I have a minus 4.9 t squared. And we're left with a quadratic equation here, but this one doesn't require the quadratic formula because that constant term is missing. I can solve it by factoring. So I have 0 equals t times 16.07 minus 4.9 t. And that equation is true if either one of the factors is equal to zero, simply because zero times anything is zero. So t equals zero is one solution, and it's there for a good reason, even though it's not the one we're interested in. And then 16.07 minus 4.9 t being equal to zero, that's the other solution. When I solve that second equation for t, so all I do is subtract 16.07 from both sides and divide by negative 4.9. I get 3.28 seconds for the flight time of the projectile. Again, that's the answer that we want to keep. What about that other answer? Why is that there? And I have to think about, what did I plug in physically into the equations, into the mathematics here? And what we plugged in was this fact that y is equal to zero. And we were asking the equations, if y is zero, what time is it? And of course, there's two places where y is equal to zero. There's the one we were interested in, the landing time. But y was also equal to zero when we first launched this thing. And the equations don't know which one we're interested in, so they deliver both solutions. In part B, we're asked for the range, that's the horizontal distance for the projectile. And pretty clearly, that's a horizontal question. So we go looking at the x-coordinate. And we know that the x-coordinate as a function of time is given by the initial x-coordinate plus the x-velocity multiplied by the flight time. And we put our origin right on the initial position. So x naught is equal to zero, and I have an x velocity of 19.15, a flight time of 3.28 seconds, and I get a total range of 62.8 meters. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.